Okay, thank you. I'm happy to be in the same panel with Sari, because we are sharing the same ideas, but we are talking about them from different angle and approach, and we are covering different aspects. As you can see, the title of this lecture, Jerusalem Past, Present, and Future, we can assume that we need hours, even days, to cover all the those aspects. So I choose to focus on four main issues regarding to the issue of Jerusalem, dealing with the past, present, and maybe future of Jerusalem. The first one is about the borders of Jerusalem, and my argument is nothing is holy about those borders. The second, about the term United Jerusalem, and I'm saying that we are dealing with two almost separate cities, Jewish and Arab. The third is about the future, and there is a necessary condition for permanent status agreement to the two-state model to have a Palestinian capital in East Jerusalem. And again, about the present, what are the current trends that we are facing over the last 10 years in Jerusalem? So let's start with the first one here about the borders of Jerusalem. And we can see the borders of the ancient Jerusalem that was not more than 2 square kilometers, which is less than 2% of the size of the city today, which included, as you can see here, the old city, and here the city of King David, the place from which everything began for the Jewish people in Jerusalem, and part here in the northern part of the old city, altogether 2 square kilometers. And this was the size of Jerusalem until the mid of the 19th century. Again, 2 square kilometers. Here, in this photograph that was taken from the from Mount of Olives in 1858, we see the city. Only inside the walls that was built in the 16th century by the Ottomans here. And 5 years later, in 1863, the first municipality was established by the Ottomans, which included only, again, the old city and the built-up area around the walls, which is less than 1 square kilometers. I would like to emphasize the point that a Jewish majority in Jerusalem, for the first time since the Bar Kokhba revolt, it means after 2,000 years, we reach a Jewish majority in Jerusalem, and we keep that until today in any kind of borders of Jerusalem. Here we can see what happened after 48 war, when the city was divided between Jordan and Israel. This part of Al-Quds was very small area, not more than 6 square kilometers. And here we have Jerusalem under the Israeli sovereignty, that Israel, between the years 48 to 67, we extend the city to the 38 square kilometers. Still very small city. Here we can see three decisions that were taken by the Israeli government after 48 war that make Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. It was in December 49 when Jerusalem declared the capital of the state of Israel, and then the Knesset decided to move to Jerusalem, and 1 month later also the government decided to relocate to Jerusalem. And here, after 67 war, we see that the Israeli government, headed by Levi Eshkol from the Labor Party, decided not only to unify Jerusalem, but also especially to extend Jerusalem. Because we decided to annex to Jerusalem not only the 6 square kilometers of Al-Quds, but 70 square kilometers, and it was immediately after the 6-day war, and we see here the new municipal borders of Jerusalem, East, what we call East Jerusalem, and of course, West Jerusalem. And then we have launched a master plan for construction in East Jerusalem. And this master plan had two main stages. The first one, we call it the Lock neighborhood. And the idea was to create a Jewish urban corridor, a Jewish contiguity between West Jerusalem to Mount Scopus, because this was the strategic area of Jerusalem. And we built the neighborhoods that you know about them, like Sanhedria Murchevet and others. Yes, Ramot Eshkol, Ma'alot Dafna, Givat HaMiftar, and others. And we finished this stage in 1971-72. And then the second stage was about, we call it the ring neighborhoods. And the idea was to build a Jewish urban ring around the Arab area, and especially to separate or to break the Palestinian contiguity on the watershed of Judea and Samaria, and build here like a urban Jewish buffer zone from the west to the east to separate Ramallah from East Jerusalem. So we build Ramot Eshkol, and later Ramat Shlomo, and also Pisgat Ze'ev. And we did the same for the southern part between Bethlehem area to East Jerusalem by building Gilo neighborhood, and later in 1996, Har Choma neighborhood. And the idea today to bridge the gap between them is by building a new Jewish neighborhood here called Givat HaMatos. Okay? And in 1968, the United Jerusalem was integrated into the Alon Plan, and the idea was to build a new area. We call it the huge triangle of Jerusalem, and the idea was to extend the narrow corridor of Jerusalem, because the distance between this line to this line here, it's not more than 6 kilometers. And the idea was to create a new triangle from Modi'in Elit area to Ma'aleh Adumim and back to Etzion block. You see, this was the idea. And of course, to implement and to achieve this idea, we need to change the demography balance between Jews and Arabs and to build settlements in this area. And I can tell you that today, more than 70% of the Israelis who are living beyond the 67 line are living here in this triangle. And to implement this plan, you see, we build Givat Ze'ev area, Ma'aleh Adumim area, and of course, a Zion block together with Betar Elit and Efrat. The situation today in Jerusalem, we can see this slide. We have today more than 500,000 Israelis, Jews, I mean. And East Jerusalem, we have more than 300,000 Palestinians and 200,000 Israelis. This is the demography balance. If in 67 it was 26% Arabs, today it's almost 40% Arabs in the total population of Jerusalem. Now, it's about the second issue, about United Jerusalem. As I said, I mean that we have two separate cities, Jewish and Arab cities, in this United Jerusalem. And I chose only few parameters just to explain it. One of these, the first one, we know that the Palestinians are only residents of the city. Only 20,000 people of them have the Israeli citizenship, and it means that they cannot participate in the Knesset election, and they don't have, of course, the Israeli passport. Part of them, because of the separation barrier, almost 20% of the Palestinian in East Jerusalem are living outside of the wall, like Kufr Aqab, Samir Amis, Shoafat refugee camp, Walaja and others. You know that we hear the questions here about boycotting the municipal election. You see that only less than 1% participated in the last election. We have two separate educational system, and we know what is the situation on the Palestinian side, lack of more than 2,000 classroom, yes, separate public transportation, different employment sectors, separate trade and recreation centers, and we know what is the situation about the poorer in the, they are poorer than the Jews in Jerusalem. Here, I brought what Ehud Olmert, who was the mayor of Jerusalem and of course the prime minister, said about Jerusalem. When it comes to other parts of Jerusalem, where Jews do not live, there is no big change. No Israeli government since 67 has done even the slight bit of what it needed to unify the city practice. And we did not invest in area that I think will not be part of Jerusalem under the sovereignty of the state of Israel. This is for almost 50 or exactly 50 years. About the third issue, there's two capitals in Jerusalem, something that Sari talked about is a necessary condition for the permanent status agreement and the two-state model. Because the issue of Jerusalem is one out of four or main issues of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Of course, the first one is two states for two people, 67 lines, and the land swap for the territorial issue, two capitals in Jerusalem. This is our issue, and just and realistic solution for the refugee and solution for the Israeli security needs. Here, the challenge is how to bridge the tension between the United Nations Resolution 242, which means, and everyone knows exactly this resolution about 67 lines, and the Israelis' interest to keep the holy places.
No 67 lines in 242.
Yes, so that's why I'm saying that everyone knows what is really have in 242 United Nations resolution, but we have, the Israeli have our interest, especially of course in the holy places, the Temple Mount and the Western Wall in East Jerusalem. And here, first of all, during the negotiation, we dealt only with East Jerusalem, how to divide East Jerusalem, this area that was annexed by Israel after 67 war with more than 200,000 Jews and more than 300,000 Arabs, these 70 square kilometers. And the idea was to do it by the demographic line or principle that was part of Clinton parameter that came out in December 2000 after Camp David summit. And here we can see on the left side what was the Israeli official proposal by Ehud Olmert in 2008 during Annapolis process. So all the 12 Jewish neighborhoods will be part of the Israeli side of the state of Israel. And all the Palestinian villages, 28, will be part of the Palestinian state, but not Beit Safafa here. Beit Safafa will be under the Israeli sovereignty. On the other side, we have Abu Mazen proposal in Annapolis 2008, the same idea. All the Palestinian villages and neighborhoods will be under the Palestinian sovereignty. The others, the Israeli Jewish neighborhood will be under the Israeli sovereignty, but not Har Choma. Why? Because הר חומה, we build it 3 years after we signed the DOP, Oslo agreement, with the PLO. I believe that we can bridge this gap, gap by keeping Har Choma under the Israeli control or sovereignty and to give them bet safafa. And here, the second part was about the old city. According to the same principle, the demographic principle, and here we can see that Abu Mazen came with the idea to keep the Walling Wall, the Jewish quarter, half of the Armenian quarter, and the rest of Mount Zion under the Israeli sovereignty. All the other is will be part of the Palestinian state. And in this point, Ehud Olmert came with different idea, and he said, you know, as a Jew, I cannot give up on the Jewish sovereignty, on the Israeli sovereignty, on the Temple Mount, but I also understand that you, as a Muslim, cannot give up on the Palestinian or Arab sovereignty on the Haram of Haram al-Sharif. So let's leave this idea and let's nominate an international committee with 5 members, Israel, Palestine, United States, Jordan, and Saudi Arabia, and let them to run this area, especially to run the holy sites without changing the status quo of those holy sites. And this was the last and real Israeli proposal how to deal with the issue of Jerusalem. And what are the fourth issue about the current trends? So first of all, we have today the barrier around Jerusalem, as you can see. And the barrier was built according to the Israeli vision how to keep Jerusalem under the Israeli sovereignty. So we can see that also Givat Ze'ev and the idea that Gush Etzion will be part of this and also Ma'ale Adumim. But we didn't finish build the fence not here around Ma'ale Adumim and not around Gush Etzion, but we also put outside of the fence, as I already mentioned, almost 90,000 Palestinians, sorry, in this area. You see here the northern part of this finger of Jerusalem, here and here. Just to reduce the number of the Palestinians inside the city without changing the legal status of the borders or of the people there. And now we are facing many ideas how to change the situation in Jerusalem to deal with this challenge if the Palestinians will take the will implement their right to vote for the municipality. So here we have one idea how to keep West Jerusalem together with the Jewish neighborhoods in East Jerusalem and also the historic basin around the old city under the Israeli control as a part of Jerusalem and separate the Arab neighborhoods, as you can see here, like Shuafat, Bet Hanina, or others, and to transfer them to the Palestinian Authority. This is one idea led by Chaim Ramon. And here we have different idea to separate totally between the Jewish neighborhoods and the Arab neighborhoods. You see here the color, but still to keep the historic basin, the holy basin, under the Israeli sovereignty. And the other people still thinking about how to enlarge Jerusalem and how to add more area to Jerusalem. And here we have something that we call it the Five Fingers Plan. It was Sharon idea in 2002-2003, how to control this area by building five fingers, we have them, almost all of them are already existing. The first one is this one, the finger from Ramot Eshkol, from Jerusalem, to Bet Horon via Givat Ze'ev. The second one is from Jerusalem to Ofra Bet El, and by doing this we are controlling the area of Ramallah and also blocking any future development of Ramallah, El Bire, and Bitunia. The same idea for Bethlehem. This ridge, the watershed, yes, the mountain back of Judea with Etzion block together with Betar Elit and Ephrat. On the other side, this is a new one, just to extend this block of Nokdim, Nechever, Ma'ale Amos, all of them part of the regional council of Etzion block, and by doing this, again, to block Bet Lechem, Bet Sachur, and El Chader, and the others here in Bet Lechem district. And to finish with this is to build this area of Ma'ale Adumim, and we know about Yoav Kish and Smutrit's proposal to annex Ma'ale Adumim to Jerusalem. Even by doing this, it means that we are separating between the northern part of the West Bank and the southern part of the West Bank, because this is the only way to reach from Ramallah to Bethlehem. Today, the Palestinians from Ramallah doing this way to Mishor Adumim and back to Ma'ale Adumim, and then using Wadi Anar to reach to Bethlehem. So by building the fence and annexing this area, we are blocking the only road that they have to do it. So there is one more plan from the Israeli side, how to build alternative road. This one, yes, for the Palestinian traffic contiguity, but still it's on the paper yet, and we didn't implement it. That's all, thank you.
Okay, we have actually two minutes more for the Q&A. So please, if you would state your name and country, and the microphone will be brought to you. But I don't see any hands up in the air. Ah, okay. Let's start over there. It's closer to you.
Hello. My name is Eddie. It was a great conference. Well done to all organizers, and not diminish of all former speakers. This was kind of saving the best for last. A lot of anniversaries were mentioned at the beginning of the conference. There is one that I think was not mentioned. 2017 is the 80th anniversary for the Peel Committee recommendation. That was the first recommendation to divide the land of Israel into the two-state solution. It has come up repeatedly for about five or six times in a concrete manner, not as an idea, and it has always ended up with the same result, not just refusal, but a violent refusal. So A, is it not time to rethink the whole idea? When I studied mathematics in high school, we never decided about the solution first and then forced it. That's called le'enos et ha'mapa. You don't force a solution. You start from the beginning and you see what you end up with. And even if you end up with a really weird answer, if you follow the rules correctly, that's the right answer. So A, is it not time for everybody to rethink this really failing idea, repeatedly failing idea? Which has also brought a lot of blood and death to all parties. So that's one. And the second to Dr. Nusseibah, I don't know if he's here.
Here.
You, it was weird that you mentioned, you repeatedly referred to the Arab population as the weaker small brother, sibling, a small child in need of defense.